Good morning. Welcome to the Academy of Neuroscience for Architecture 2012 conference. I'm Alison Whitelaw, I'm the president. And I just want to briefly tell you formally what the mission of the Academy is. The mission of the Academy is to promote and advance knowledge that links neuroscience research to a growing understanding of human responses to the built environment. So you'll hear more about the history of ANFA over the course of the lecture. The Academy was founded in 2003 as the legacy project for the American Institute of Architects convention that was in San Diego that year. And over the years, we've developed a network of interdisciplinary relationships. We've promoted education at the intersection between the disciplines. We've appointed research associates who have worked across the disciplinary situations. We've sponsored various workshops focusing on neuroscience research and specific building types. We have presented at various conferences throughout the country and around the world, held our own lecture series, and we've disseminated a growing body of information through our website. So many people, I have to say, were instrumental in the Academy's beginnings and its growth over the years. And many of them you'll meet over the course of the next 2 days. You'll meet most of the board members since they're either presenting or introducing our contributed presentations. And the reason that we're holding this conference is because a year and a half or 2 years ago, ANFA became the beneficiary of a generous bequest. And we'll be giving you more details on the Harold Hay Research Grant Program later on in the conference. But for now, let's suffice it to say that the board identified this conference as a way to sow some seeds for interdisciplinary research that might be pursued by any of you, given the opportunities of knowledge sharing and relationship building offered by the conference. So we hope that each of you will capitalize on this opportunity, reach out to other conference attendees, form new relationships, think about some research that you might want to pursue. But first of all, we have some thanks that are due. Our thanks to the Salk Institute for allowing us to use this magnificent facility for our conference, and especially to Inga Johnson, who helped us organize it. When you organize your first conference, it's quite a challenge. Our thanks go to our generous sponsors, whose support has made the conference possible. They are listed in the back of your booklet. We're most grateful to our willing and enthusiastic volunteers who've given generously of their time. They're listed in your conference booklet also, but I'd especially like to point out a couple of them. Matt Smith, who took ownership of the continuing education component of the conference, and did just a yeoman's duty putting that together. We're offering plenty of AIA learning units as well as ELAC units. And to Lily Robinson, who single-handedly put together our tour program, because we have tours at the Salk Institute and the Sanford Consortium for Regenerative Medicine after the proceedings tomorrow afternoon. If you haven't signed up for that yet, there's a table in the lobby. We have two consultants who performed miracles, in my view, to organize this conference. Kate Mears, who's sitting in the front row, she joined us specifically to help organize the conference, and her graphic skills are responsible for all the conference graphics that you've seen, the booklet and the posters and so on. And to Alison Vassallo, who is highly effective, absolutely indefatigable, and without whom this conference would not be possible. She's probably not even in here right now to hear this. And finally, I want to thank the board members. We have a wonderful board of coming from both disciplines. They've contributed in various ways to the conference planning, and who throughout the life of ANFA bring so much in the way of leadership, intellectual capital, and collegiality. So some brief logistics quickly. Architects, the continuing education sessions. ANFA is an approved AIA continuing education provider. See the course catalogue that you received at the front table when you signed up for today's courses for the required provider information. If you didn't yet sign up, make sure you do that in the break if you want to get AIA learning units. Plenty are available. We're also an approved provider for EDAC, the Evidence-Based Design Accreditation and Certification Program. You will need to keep your own records for that. For the AIA learning units, we'll be submitting them for you as long as you have signed up. To all of you, your booklet is your proof of registration, so please wear it for all events. Tomorrow you won't need to sign in at the registration desk, but you will need to sign in for AIA learning units tomorrow as well. We're currently in the development of a reference database that will expand the knowledge that we make available through our webpage. Board member David Kirsch, is he in the room? Not yet, he'll be here later, is taking the lead on this. And one of the first steps we did was to review the references that each of the contributed presentations submitted to see what kind of citations were in there. We're also contacting Architecture and Neuroscience faculty internationally. And David invites you, if you have any thoughts about citations that we might want to consider including in this database, to visit the table in the lobby, which is it's the same table as the continuing education table, and to there will be a webpage reference that you can pick up to submit your citations. Please do not bring any food or drink into the auditorium. Water is acceptable, but nothing else if you could please help us with that. And then I also want to explain a little bit about the conference format. There is a tremendous amount of information packed into this conference. We did this on purpose. We had more contributed submittals than we expected. When we went through them all, we saw that there were a lot that were really meritorious and we wanted to include them. Timing is going to be very tight and information is going to be thrown at you the entire conference. For some of you, it may be overwhelming. We certainly understand if you need to sit a few sessions out. But we did select the best of the contributed presentations and we're fortunate enough to have some outstanding speakers and panelists, all experts in their field. Like I said, timing is tight. We will be asking presenters to work within their allotted time. We have a timekeeper up front, okay? She will be holding up 5 minute and 1 minute warnings. And please observe these. Changeover of presenters on the platform will need to happen pretty swiftly. And all presenters who brought PowerPoint presentations are asked to please to get them to the AV people well in advance. We have a couple of speaker and contributed speaker hosts who can help you with that, who I hope you've met in the lobby. If not, check in at the registration desk and you can be pointed to the right person. We also have poster sessions in the lobby. During the half-hour coffee breaks, there will be poster presentations. The presentation schedule is posted on its own poster, so you can see who's going to be presented. And feel free to peruse all of the posters during the breaks. And then the tours on Saturday afternoon will leave immediately after the final proceedings in the auditorium, and we just ask you to gather in the lobby to be assigned to your tour guide. So with that, it's now my great pleasure to introduce a very special person. This is a great friend and mentor who's inspired many of us and has been with ANFA from the beginning. Without him, ANFA would not exist. John Paul Eberhard, FAIA, was the founding president of ANFA. He earned his BS in architectural design from the University of Illinois, MS in industrial management from MIT. His career highlights include serving as director for the Institute for Applied Technology, dean of architecture and environmental design at SUNY Buffalo, president of AIA Research Corporation, and head of the Department of Architecture at Carnegie Mellon. Eberhard's expertise and passion for the intersection of architecture and neuroscience are demonstrated through his work as a Latrobe Fellow, as well as his continuing guidance and dedication to ANFA. So please help me welcome John Eberhardt.
I used to say I did all that before I was 35, but I can't do that anymore now that I'm 85. It's my pleasure to introduce this session, which actually will be formalized when Rusty Gage presents his talk. But I wanted to say a few words about consilience of neuroscience and architecture. Neil Wilson, the famous biologist, has proposed the theory of how dialogues between disciplines can create a consilience, a unity of understanding. He asserted that the sciences, humanities, and arts have a common goal to give purpose to all inquirers, a conviction far deeper than a mere working proposition that the world is orderly and can be explained by a small number of natural laws. As an example, in 1628, Dr. William Harvey was making history with his experiments on the heart and with his discoveries of how blood passes through the heart. Harvey was concerned that humanists and poets who celebrated the heart as the center of emotions, especially love, would be opposed to his novel and unheard-of scientific discoveries. He hoped that the trust of cultivated minds would enable him to gain a new ground once there was a consilience of the romantic concepts with his scientific findings. Eric Kandel, a Nobel Prize winner for his work on the brain, says that the discovery of the molecular structure of DNA by James Watson and Francis Crick, who spent the last years of his life working here at South, made it possible to unify the disciplines of biochemistry, genetics, immunology, cell biology, cancer biology, and molecular neurobiology, setting a precedent for other disciplines. He suggested that a merger is developing between the science of the mind and the science of the brain, which will likely produce a new understanding of how the brain responds to works of art, and I would add to works of architecture. They will help explain how we humans process conscious and unconscious perceptions, emotions, and empathy. That's what the Academy of Neuroscience for Architecture is based on. We've been active in the Academy. Development believe a consilience is developing between the brain sciences and architecture. And that's what we wish to demonstrate and explore in this symposium. The spaces we are surrounded by here at the Salk Institute, created by Lou Kahn and inspired by Dennis Salk, are more than the frozen music of architecture. They are the essence of consilience. No better person could be found than Rusty Gage, a world-renowned neuroscientist whose laboratories are here at the Salk Institute, and who served as the president of our academy from 2004 to 2006. He received his Bachelor's of Science degree from the University of Florida and a PhD from Johns Hopkins University. Rusty's Laboratory of Genetics at the Salk Institute has concentrated on the adult central nervous system and the unexpected plasticity and availability that remains throughout the life of all mammals. This work may lead to methods of replacing brain tissues lost to strokes or Alzheimer's disease. And here he is to talk about how changes in the environment affect the brain. Rusty.